Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. All right. Hey, Merry Christmas. I hope you are enjoying this Christmas season once again. I'm so glad that you have chosen to come and worship with us this morning. I'm just absolutely delighted that you would be here as we worship our risen Savior during this Christmas season. As always, if you are a guest or somebody that's been here for a few months and just have not connected with us, please take one of these connect cards that's in the pew in front of you, fill it out, and take it back to our connect center. We have a small gift for you that we want to give to you. We do enjoy, truly enjoy getting to know new people and from all walks of life. And so we want to know you, and hopefully you want to get to know us, and most importantly, we want to be able to share the love of Jesus with you even more. It is just fun to be able to get to know new people. Several people have come to faith this past year because they've been brand new to Cedar Crest, and we just love it, love it, love it. So go ahead and do that. Some very important details here. Now, here's my caveat for us. Our communications director, Lauren Skinker, is going to yell out if I get any of this wrong, okay? If he doesn't yell out and there's something wrong, it's his fault. Okay. Next Sunday, all the children are invited into this worship service, okay? It is the day before Christmas. There is no Christmas service. Christmas Day service. There is no Christmas Day service. Christmas is on a Monday, so everybody's got that clear, right? Some people thought we were having a Christmas Day service. There's no Christmas Day service. Our normal next Sunday morning at 10 a.m., there is no blast off or skyrocket during that church service. It's only the nursery. So all the children are invited to come into the worship service. There is no DI next Sunday as well, okay? So there's no Sunday school beforehand. Has everybody got that clear? Am I good so far, Lauren? All right, they've all shaken their heads to say they understand. Okay, good. Now, DI has taken, today was the last day for this semester for DI. They're taking a two-week break, okay? Two-week break. So next Sunday and then the following Sunday, there is a break for DI. On the 27th, there is skyrocket and blast off again, okay? For parents with skyrocket and blast off, so you bring your children to the church service, and then they will go to the skyrocket and blast off. Once again, there's no DI, so there's no Sunday school as well. Now, how many church services are we having on Christmas Day? All right, zero. Good, okay. All right. Now, what comes before Christmas Day that we always do here at the church? Christmas Eve, that's all right. Okay, so Christmas Eve is going to be here at 6:30 p.m. Grab one of these invite cards. You have friends, family, neighbors. Invite them to come to Christmas Eve with you. We're not just about the church service. We're not just a Christmas Eve service. We're about celebrating Jesus Christ. And as you know, your friends have lots of questions. They have lots of worries. They have lots of just many things going on in their life. And the one answer that we can consistently come back to is Jesus Christ. So yes, we are celebrating Jesus Christ because he is the answer to all of our problems, especially our sin problem. Does that make sense? So love your neighbors, love your friends, love your family. Invite them to come to this as well. So, all right. Now we also have a new semester of DI, our Discipleship Institute, which starts at 8:45 on Sunday mornings. Now, some of you, have trouble getting up that early, but I highly encourage you to get up there early and come. We have a couple of different classes coming up that you can sign up today. One is really led by a very handsome man. I don't know who this is, but Adam Crane is... It's the instruments in the Redeemer's hands. And I'm really excited about teaching this class. This class is about love, know, speak, and do. Dr. Paul Tripp, many of you and I know who Paul Tripp is, wrote a book called Instruments in the Redeemer's Hands. It's about coming alongside others, understanding how they transform in the likeness of Christ and coming alongside them and helping them grow in Christ. One of my big heartbeats is for this church body to grow in love and understanding of each other. And so that's my class. We also have one on prayer by Rick Whitmire. He gets the award for teaching four classes in a row here. Not yet. This will be the fourth class and stuff. A very highly effective teacher. I encourage you to read the description and to come as well. And then we also have how to understand the Bible. This is a wonderful class to be able to come to. And there's a little something underneath here is that we want all of you who are teaching to attend this class. It doesn't matter if you are teaching just the children, the men's, the youth and stuff. If you have a part of a teaching ministry here, we really want you to come to How to Read the Bible so that we can invite you to come to a next class that we're going to start requiring for everybody so we can encourage people to grow in their understanding of how they're teaching and how they, and so we can just equip you more and more. So read all the description as well. And then also, if you really want to become a member here at Cedar Crest, we're going to offer a membership class once again next DI. And so I encourage you to sign up for the membership class as well to get to know us and so we get to know you and to be able to come in covenant relationship with us. Sounds good? I did not hear Lauren yell or scream or anything, so everything I have said has been affirmed by him. So this morning. So, hey, but let's worship the Lord together. We have some baptisms again. And so very excited about having baptisms. Wonderful to see them last week, and we get to see them again this week, and just awesome to see what the Lord Jesus Christ, who is personally doing in people's lives. Amen?
Hi, my name is Joanne Freeman. For 60-plus years, I've been a practicing Catholic. I was baptized at birth. My adult life just seemed to be checking off all the boxes. Church on Sundays, holy days, going to confession, and saying my prayers. Mostly I believed I was being a good person and that I would go to heaven. Church for me was part of my weekly routine. I was feeling like I was being lectured at and talked at, but being a good Catholic, I didn't question. I don't remember being encouraged to read the Bible, but I did hear many nice Bible stories. And a few years ago, my son Billy and my daughter-in-law Liana invited me to attend services with them. Frankly, it was a little out of my comfort zone, not the format I was used to. But I found it very pleasant, and over the last 4 years have attended services with them. And afterwards, Billy would always ask me my thoughts, what they were on the sermon, prompt conversation, and explain any questions I had or ask my thoughts. He was always making me think, and I began to question my beliefs. I then realized I had not been living my life according to the Bible. This was just my beginning. Over time, my eyes have been opened to my life with Christ. The past few months, I didn't know how to move forward, so when the membership classes began, it was my perfect opportunity to begin my journey. And as Acts 22:16 sums up perfectly what I needed to do. And now what are you waiting for? Get up and be baptized and wash your sins away, calling on his name. I am happy and excited for the journey that lies ahead.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Joanne, can you testify that through repentance towards God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, that you have received forgiveness of your sins and now enjoy peace with God? If so, answer yes.
Yes.
It is our privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
I asked Jesus to be my Savior when I was 6 years old, and I remember being afraid to pray, but eventually I asked Jesus to be Lord of my life. At first, I didn't really seemed to change much. I was still the average young kid. However, last year in sixth grade, I started attending Lehigh Christian Academy, and I felt something change. In past years in school, I felt like a normal kid, but at LCA, I didn't, because I felt like God was calling me. And it was like the spark that ignites a fire. The environment at LCA was just way better. The kids and the teachers, they were a whole lot friendlier. Everything about school was Christ-centered. Mrs. Conway and Mrs. Fennell, two of my teachers, would tell us that they would be praying for us. Mrs. Fennell ran a club called Heroes of Faith. One thing I learned was that even when God seems like he isn't there, doesn't care, and just lets things happen to you, he's still there. He still cares. He's still loving, caring, and faithful. This past summer, my friend Michael, who's also one of my classmates, invited me to a camp called Pocono Mountain Bible Conference. There, Pastor Mark, who happens to be a teacher at LCA, put a number on sin to illustrate. He said that If the average human sinned 3 times a day, that's over 1,000 times a year. If you multiply that by however old you are, that's tens of thousands of sins in your lifetime. He said that Jesus still loved us enough to go to the cross and bear all those sins. Every person, and I just couldn't wrap my head around that. That made me realize I needed to live for Christ. So I'm trying to read His word more, pray more, and I want to learn more about Him. I'm learning His discipline is out of love. It may seem like you're disciplined because your parents don't like you, but they want to correct you. Discipline is meant to correct you. It's meant to help you not make the same mistakes twice. And I want to get baptized because it's one of God's commandments. And I want to publicly say that I want to follow Christ.
Amen. Caden, can you testify that through repentance towards God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, that you have experienced the forgiveness of sins and now enjoy peace with God? If so, answer yes.
Yes.
It is our privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
When I was a little boy, I remember going to church. But as I got older, I slowly drifted from the church because I didn't understand. And as I look back, I now know I am a sinner. Shortly after Don and I got married, we started going back to church. Things happened, and at the time, I said I would not go back to church again. Probably my anger and bitterness got in the way of that, and I'm sure that was not in the best interest of God. And my thoughts were, I don't need church. Now I know Satan was in my head. Before I started going back to church, my sister Kelly inspired me. When I was at my lowest, I could call her and talk to her. She would sometimes tell me a Bible verse or have a prayer. There were times it would pick me up and times I didn't want to hear it. So to my sister Kelly, thank you. I couldn't have done this without you. It's been about 26 years since I've been in the church, but somehow the good Lord brought me to this church. I truly believe I was saved in this church. I remember sitting in the church for the very first time in years. I can honestly say it was very hard that morning because I was so emotional, because I was still angry with God. I asked God to forgive me for being angry and for my sins. I could feel Him overcome me while I was sitting in church. And I truly believe God was telling me, I'm here for you, Scott. Now with Christ Jesus in my life, things are better. Satan works on me more now than ever. And I struggle, but with God on my side, I can conquer anything. Romans 6, 3 through 5 reads, have you forgotten that we were joined with Christ Jesus in baptism? We joined Him in His death. We died and we were buried with Christ by baptism. And just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we also may live new lives.
Amen. Scott, can you testify that through repentance towards God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, you have experienced the forgiveness of your sins and now enjoy peace with God?
Yes.
Amen. It is our privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Hello, my name is Dwight. I am in sixth grade and I am 11 years old. And my view on the gospel before I was saved was God's word and something for me to read. I didn't really think of it much, but my view on the gospel now is that it is about God, sin, which keeps us away from God, what Jesus did for us, and faith. The Lord drew me to Him at Victory Valley Camp in the final few days of it. And during those days, I thought more about what they were telling me, what I already knew, and what I wanted to do. So I knew in my heart that I wanted to have a closer relationship with the Lord. And when I got back from Victory Valley, my dad led me to Christ. He helped me get a better relationship with him. And I take responsibility for this by reading, praying, and meditating on the Word. I want to be baptized because I want to grow my relationship with Jesus through obedience and being buried and raised with him. And this, to me, is an outward symbol of an inward change.
Amen. Dwight, can you testify that through repentance towards God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, that you have experienced the forgiveness of sins and now enjoy peace with God? If so, answer yes.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. It is our privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Praise the Lord. Amen. If you're able, I invite you to stand with us as we begin our time of worship and song. Give us one moment here while we transition.
The uncreated one, the author of salvation, who wrote the laws of space and time, and fashioned worlds to his design, the one whom angels most revere, hung the stars like chandeliers, numbered every grain of sand, knows the heart of every man. He is King forever, He is King forever, He is King forevermore. And our strength, the rock on which we can depend, matchless in his majesty, his power and authority, unshaken by his schemes of man, never changing, great I am. Kingdoms rise and kingdoms fall. He is faithful through it all. Crown him King forever. Crown him King forever. Crown him King forevermore. Mighty God in mortal flesh, forsaken by a traitor's kiss, the curse of sin and centuries did pierce the lowly Prince of Peace. Lifted high, the sinless man, crucified, the spotless lamb, buried by the sons of man, and he was rescued by his Father's hand to reign as King forever. Reign as King forever. Reign as King forevermore. King eternal God of grace, we crown you in
Christ, King of kings forever, King of kings forever, King of kings forevermore.
Just our voices.
Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ the Lord. We'll give You
thank you.
save us, Prince of Peace and Lord of all.
Cry to you.
Out of the depths I cry to you. In darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew and hear my cry for mercy. Come before your throne, yet full forgiveness meets my gaze. I stand redeemed by grace alone. I will wait for you, I will wait for you. On your word I will rely.
For you, for your love is my delight. Good morning. What a wonderful morning it's been to witness the public baptism of these individuals. It is so neat to hear their testimonies and their stories and to see God working in young and old alike. This is a great time of celebration as we look forward to Christmas. And my heart was taken to Isaiah 26 recently. And I just want to read a couple verses 8 and 9. And these verses, I think, are describing, as believers, where our focus needs to be in life. Isaiah 26, 8 and 9. In the path of your judgments, O Lord, we wait for you. Your name and remembrance are the desire of our souls. May our souls yearn for you in the night. May our spirits within us earnestly seek you. Would you join with me as we go to our great God in prayer? Father, we come to you, a broken people. Lord, we are reminded every day of the sin in the world, the sin that reigns in our own hearts. And Lord, thank you that you did not leave us. Thank you that in your incomprehensible love, you desired a relationship with us. You sent Christ to come to earth, to live as one of us, to do what we can't do, to live a perfect life. And then, Lord, on top of it all, to go to the cross to bear our sin so that we could have a relationship with you. Lord, would you increase in our hearts a desire for you that in the middle of the night, whether we're rejoicing or weeping, that our desire would be for you. Lord, I'm just so excited for the answers to prayer that you give. And Lord, I just give you the praise for Caleb Whitmire's successful surgery. And Lord, he is home today, earlier than expected. He went home yesterday. And we just give you the praise for helping him to heal and continue to help him. And thank you for hearing our prayers and continue to encourage the Whitmire family. And continue to help Caleb as he recovers from this successful surgery. Lord, we just pray for those in our midst who are suffering because of illness. Lord, I know there's been some brothers and sisters in our family who now have cancer, and they just got the news here recently. And would you just encourage them as they face this prospect? Lord, those in our midst who are suffering because they have lost a loved one this year. Many of us have lost a parent. Some of us have lost a spouse, a child. Would you be close and encourage us as we mourn the loved ones? Father, those of us, some of us are battling physical issues that don't seem to go away. Would you encourage us, help us to keep our eyes on you? Help us to desire you more than anything else. Lord, some of us are heartbroken because we have loved ones who are not turning or not humming themselves towards you or have walked away from you. And Lord, our hearts grieve over those, and we pray that you would call them to yourself and save them from their sins. Lord, I thank you for Paul Heckenberger. And Lord, I ask that you'd help him, Lord, as he's in a season where he just can't join us, Lord. He's physically incapable. So meet with him this morning in a special way. Help us to show him in tangible ways our love for him, and just encourage him in his heart right now in this time of life. Lord, we pray for Kimberly Dean, who is our focused college student of the week. Would you just encourage her as she studies, as she desires to pursue a career that you've called her to do? And may she be a light and a testimony amongst her college campus, and help her to just grow in her walk with you, Father. Lord, I thank you for the many leaders and people that you've called to create this local church we call Cedar Crest. And I think particularly of Ricky Whitmire and John Rapp, our elder and deacon of the week. Would you just continue to encourage these men, give them the wisdom to administer their roles well and wisely. And Lord, we pray for our pastors as well. Give them strength and encouragement. Help them, Lord, when they're weary. I pray for my brother, Chris, as he preaches the word this morning. Help him to speak to us through your word, that we may give us ears to hear and hearts that would be transformed by the power of your word, Father. And Lord, help us, each one of us, to be willing to share this great news with those around us. May we just continue to be a church that's known to spread the gospel, to share those in the Lehigh Valley and around the world. And Lord, before I close, I do want to think of and pray for a request that came to me this morning for someone in our midst, a little infant boy named Mateo Klepats, and I think I'm pronouncing his name right. I know Tracy, the grandmother, comes here, and he was admitted to the hospital yesterday, viral bronchitis. So will you just touch his little body, Lord? Lord, we've seen you do great works of miracles and healing folks, and so we pray that you'd heal Mateo in a special way. Lord, thank you again for this morning. We just commit all these things in your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. Children, you are dismissed to go to children's church. Thank you.
Good morning to you. And Merry Christmas. Thank you. So kind of you. We're going to be in Colossians chapter 1 this morning, so you can turn in your Bibles to Colossians chapter 1. So Pastor Jason has emphasized the past 2 weeks that this Christmas season, our heart's desire is that we as a church would really see and savor who this infant, lowly, infant, holy is. We want to put Christmas in its redemptive historical context. We can become very nearsighted during the holidays, seeing even the miracle of the incarnation without meditating on who he is and why he came, feeling the gravitas of God becoming flesh. This is our heart as pastors for us this season, that we as a church acknowledge, believe, and worship the Christ of Christmas in all of his splendor, in all of his majesty. Paul had the same goal for the church at Colossae as they read his letter. He wanted his readers to really understand who Jesus is every time he mentioned him in this short, as we have broken it down to, 4-chapter letter, and it is no less than 46 times that he references the Son of God. I want to read this text with you this morning. Read with me in verses, or follow along with me rather, in verses 15 through verse 20. He, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we can come to you always. We thank you for your holy word that you have given to us through the prophets, through the apostles, and through your Son. We thank you, Lord, for texts like this that reorient us. Lord, as we were singing this morning, my mind was running in 1,000 different directions, and by your grace, you had to rein me in. We become so easily distracted that we fail to see this, the preeminence, the supremacy of the Son of God. Lord, would you help us now amidst all these distractions, amidst everything swirling around in our minds, on our mobile devices, in our hearts, the hurts, the lusts, the distractions, whatever it might be, the cares. Lord, help us to center our hearts and focus on the Son of God. And I pray this in his name. Amen. It is clear from the context of Colossians that chapter 1, verses 15 through 20 stands out on its own. In theory, you could read Colossians 1, 1 through 14, jump right to verse 21, and not miss the flow of Paul's argument. However, we would certainly miss the weight of Paul's argument. Paul transitions his focus here in verses 12 through 14 on our thanksgiving towards the Father, all of a sudden mentioning the Son that he translated us from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of his dear Son. And then he goes, whom, or he is, rather, the image. He jumps right into the Son. And then he picks up his argument in verse 16. Many believe that this was a Christological hymn of the early church that Paul either utilized, modified, or wrote himself in order to emphasize the Son of God. In this short hymn, the Son is referred to 13 times. In this short section, we read, he is, by him, through him, for him, he is, in him, he is, that he might be, in him, through him, to himself, by the blood of his cross. The hymn's about him. No pun intended. In reference to him, the Son, we read all-encompassing phrases, eight of them, like this. All creation, all things, all things, all things, all things, everything, in the or all the fullness, and again, all things. What is Paul's point? As a result of who the Son of God has always been, and what the Son of God has accomplished in redemptive history, he is over all. Christ is over all. He is over all in authority, over all in power, over all in importance, over all in glory, over all in accomplishment, and ought to be above all and over all in our hearts. Paul's purpose for inserting this Christological doxology right here in this letter is so that whenever we read of Jesus in Colossians, and I would add in the whole Bible, that we would view him and trust him and savor him as he is presented here. And this is the argument of Colossians 1, 1 15 through 20, that Jesus Christ is over all because he created all, he sustains all, and he reconciles all. That's the main point of this text, that Jesus Christ is over all because he created all, he sustains all, and he reconciles all things to himself. I want you to see with me before we jump into walking through this passage to help you understand kind of the map of how this is laid out, is there's two major sections, two strophes, if you will, of this poetic Christological hymn. Verses 15 through 16 at the beginning, and then verses 18b through 20 at the end. And then in the middle, verses 17 through 18a, is a transition. So we're going to see a main point in the beginning and the end, and a transitional point right in the middle. You tracking with me? All right. So pay attention to that, because you see parallels between the first point and the last point. and then a bridge right in the middle. So that's what I want to help you see now as we go in and dive into the text. The first point we want to hit on is that Christ is over all because he created all. Christ is over all because he created all. That's the point of verses 15 through 16. Listen to what it says. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn, you could say, the Lord of all creation. Why? For by him all things were created. That's the point. And we see these two words used to describe the Son, image and firstborn. Let's talk about image of God. We hear echoes of Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 27, that humanity, mankind, was created in God's image to reflect him, to represent him, to all of creation, to rule on his behalf, to image God, that when creation sees us, we see something of God in one another. However, it goes much further for the Son of God, because it does not say in our text, he is created in the image of God. It says he is the image of God. There's a difference. We see this is telling us he's the divine Son. We see echoes of John 1, what we heard preached on last week, particularly verse 14 and 18, where John says, no one has ever seen God. He's invisible. The only God who is at the Father's side, that's the Son, he has made him, the Father, known. Hebrews 1:3 tells us that Jesus, the Son, is the radiance of the glory of God, and not just the image, but the exact imprint of his nature, not created in God's image, exists as God's image. And if you think about it this way, my friends, the divine Son is the image that we were created in. His image is the one that we marred in the fall, and his image is the one that we are being conformed to in redemption. Do you see? The divine Son is the image of God and has always been the image of God to us. He makes the invisible God visible. Stephen Wellham puts it this way, no one has ever seen God, writes John, but the only God who is at the Father's side, he has made him known. Here, Paul, in Colossians, makes the same point by declaring that the Son has perfectly reflected the Father from eternity and now perfectly reveals the invisible God in the incarnate Christ. Only a divine Son can be this image. So he's the image, which tells us his role, so to speak, is to show us who God is, but he can only show us who God is in his fullness, if he is God in his fullness. So he's the image of the invisible God. He's also the firstborn of all creation. This has Old Testament messianic allusions to it. We read of the Davidic king in Psalm 89:27, where God says, I will make him the firstborn, and then he tells us what he means by that. The highest of the kings of the earth. This idea of the Son being the firstborn connotes status, not origin. Pastor Hoy talked about that last week. It does not say that he is the firstborn from creation, but of creation, over creation. Douglas Moo tells us that the word firstborn here takes on a metaphorical significance based on the ancient attribution of preeminence to be firstborn. The firstborn inherited all the rights and the privileges of his father. The divine Son is the rightful recipient of all creation, this text tells us. Lord of all, over all. Why? Because he is the creator of all things. Without him, nothing was made that was made. By him, this text tells us, in verse 16, for by him all things were created. That's all encompassing. The idea of created means to bring into existence. Everything that exists has been brought into existence by him. Everything. Nothing left out. The divine Son is the rightful owner of all creation because he brought all creation into existence. But Paul doesn't stop there. He doesn't just give us this broad idea. He gets specific in order to show us his ownership of all things in every category. He starts broadly with these categories in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Those are probably parallels to one another. This text tells us that everything that we can see, every star, every planet, Every moon, every asteroid, every comet, every meteor, every cloud, every ocean, every mountain, every river, every valley, every tree, every plant, every blade of grass, every animal, every human, every molecule, every atom owes its existence to this divine Son, and He owns it all. But not just that. Every created thing we cannot see, every heavenly realm, every spirit, every angel, every cherub, every seraph, yes, every demon owes their existence to the Son. And then He gets even more specific. He goes from things that we can see, things that we cannot see, things in the heavenly realm, things in the earthly realm, and He gets even more specific, and He jumps into this idea of authorities and power. Look at what He says. Whether thrones or dominions, or rulers or authorities. And most commentators believe that that is explaining the invisible. Because of the context in Colossians, talking about Him disarming the rulers and the authorities in chapter 2, which are the demonic realm. Ephesians 1:21, also written by Paul, that Jesus Christ is far above all rule and authority and power and dominion in reference to the demonic realm. Basically saying the highest power, the highest created power in all the universe, the devil and his angels, that Jesus Christ created them. The highest authority you can think of. The authorities behind the earthly authorities that we see, Jesus Christ created them all. So reason one, that He is the Lord, the firstborn of all creation, is that He created all things, and Paul means all things. Secondly, though, it's also because He is the owner of all things. Don't miss this in the text. Look at the text, verse 16. All things were created through Him. So He's summing up what He said. And then He adds, and for Him. Don't miss that. All that exists in the universe exists for the Son. That's everything's purpose. Did you know that? All created things were made for Him. We're made ultimately for Him, and all that exists in the universe belongs to the Son. That indicates ownership. And all that exists in the universe was created to acknowledge the Son, which points to worship. This text tells us our purpose, who we belong to, and who we owe all loyalty and allegiance and worship to. And it's focused on creation. Our culture, through the classroom, ads, books, movies, sitcoms, video games, pornography, and everything else, has indoctrinated us to believe that our lives, our time, our thoughts, our possessions, our homes, our cars, careers, hobbies, relationships, are all achieved by us and for us, that the supreme reason for our existence is to make much of ourselves. The American church, by and large, with the veneer of Christianese, has done the same. Christianity has been presented as a smorgasbord, an avenue for you to achieve or to glean or to take what you want. Just look at how many churches gather, multiple service times, multiple music genres, multiple styles. It's all about the people in the church. This tells us, my friends, the purpose of our lives, that we were created for the Son. He is over all because He created all and He owns all. Now at this point in the hymn, after verse 16, at verse 17, Paul begins his transition from the Son being creator of all to the Son being reconciler of all. Verse 15 starts off with, He is the image. Verse 18b, halfway through the verse, starts off with, He is the beginning. That's the parallel. These are the two major reasons the Son is over all. But in between these two major reasons is a transition and another reason that He is over all. Verses 17 through 18a, I want you to see this. Christ is over all because He sustains all. Not only did He create everything that we see, He sustains everything that we see and cannot see. Look at verse 17 with me in your Bibles. And He is before all things. And in Him, all things hold together. And He is the head of the body of the church. See that parallelism? And He is before all things, and He is the head of the body of the church, and in the middle, and in Him, all things hold together. There's the bridge. He's the creator in eternity past. He existed before everything. He is before everything, which connects us back to verses 15 through 16. But now, Paul tells us that he is also the sustainer in the present. He holds all things together. He brings coherence and unity to our universe. He is the providential God who cares for, works, and gives intention. He gives attention and is involved in every single moment of human history. If Jesus Christ were to let go, we would all be incinerated. Our universe is coherent. It is ordered. We do not fear, or at least I do not, that our globe will randomly spin faster than one turn every 24 hours. I hate merry-go-round, so that would be terrible. Or that we will move farther away from the sun so that we freeze, or closer to the sun so that we are incinerated. Why? Because the Son of God sustains all things. Jesus has always and continues to hold everything together. Every blasphemous word is a gift from his hand. Not the blasphemy, but the breath. Every immoral act committed against his majesty, he grants the person the strength to do so. Hebrews 1:3 says, after saying that he is the exact imprint of God's nature, parallel to our text, that he upholds the universe by the word of his power. Just as the word of John 1 created all things, the same word sustains all things. So not only do all things owe their existence to the Son, but all things, all people everywhere owe our continued existence to the Son. The breath you just took, the beats your hearts just exercised, the ears that hear my voice, your eyes that see me, you owe to the Son of God. Do we use our God-given breath to praise him or to curse him? Do we use our God-given thoughts to cherish him or to neglect him? Do we use our God-given time on his world to advance his kingdom, which will last forever, or on our kingdom, which will burn? Do we thank the Son of God, not merely for making us, but for keeping us? See, the Son of God is not an owner who created all things to sell them or abandon them. The Son created all things to care for and uphold them. Now, hold on a minute, you might ask. Pause here. This earth is far from perfect, especially our bodies. It seems as if the Son is not thriving in his role of preservation. Your observation of the world around you is correct, and the fact that he sustains the universe to the degree that he does when we have rebelled against him, my friends, is grace in and of itself. However, he does not and will not leave us in this state of decay, disorder, disease, and death. Because this text tells us, and the bridge begins with he is the head of the body of the church, that he is the reconciler of the future. He is before all things. He is Lord of creation in verse 17. He sustains all things. He's the keeper of creation. But then he's the head of the church, which is meaning he is the start of the new creation. And we're going to see this fleshed out more and more. What's interesting, though, is he's not just head of the church in the same way as he's head of creation. He stands over creation as its Lord, and yet Paul says over his church, he's connected to us like a head to a body. There's an intimacy here. And his people, you and I, if we're trusting in Christ, are a part of this new creation that he is beginning. In Genesis, we see that creation climaxed. It ended with humanity. In the new creation, it begins with a new humanity, which transitions us to the final point, that Christ is over all because he reconciles all things. He reconciles all. This is the final point of the hymn where we see the end goal of history itself and our connection to the Christ of Christmas that we worship. Again, reminding us, verse 15 began with he is the image and referred to the Son as the firstborn of all creation. Now verse 18a begins with he is the beginning and refers to the Son as the firstborn from the dead. Look at verse 18 with me, the middle of verse 18. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things. That's the point of this text. or this section, the first section, create all things. In this section, reconcile all things, whether on earth or in heaven. Again, echoing back to the first section, making peace by the blood of his cross. We see beginning and we see firstborn again. Just as he is the creator of the original creation, all that we see and cannot see, he is also the founder, the beginning of the new creation. But there's a difference I want you to notice here, which makes his incarnation so grand. Excuse me. When the Son of God created the universe, he did so by his word. The picture scripture gives us in Genesis is that God created by speaking all things into existence. Let there be light, and there was light, right? The picture scripture gives us, what we see in this text is that the Son of God does not recreate through his word, but through his death. Think about that for a minute. He's not firstborn over all creation in the same way that he in the new creation as he is in the first. Now, I'm not saying he's not the Lord of all, the recreator of all. Don't miss me on that. But notice how important words are. Look at verse 15, second part. The firstborn of all creation. Look at verse 18b. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. What the Son of God did was he himself, in order to bring about this new creation, entered into it. He didn't stand aloof to it or just merely above it, though he is above it. He came and he lived and he died and he rose again. That's how he recreates the new creation. Is he enters into it himself. He doesn't merely speak into existence and speak sustaining words of power. He enters into it and actually succumbs to its power momentarily and then rises again and conquers it. That's what we see here in this text. Why? Why did the Son of God enter into his fallen creation to initiate its recreation? Another parallel. Look at this. The firstborn from the dead, the first one who's over the dead, the first one to rise from the dead and conquer it, that in everything he might be preeminent. All things were created through him and for him. His role of recreation is so that he might be preeminent. Do you see the parallel? So, God created all things through his Son so that his Son might be preeminent in creation. But then this is what happens. The creation decides, no, we want to be preeminent. I want to be preeminent. And then you have 7 billion people on this planet competing for a throne. And so the Son says, no, I love my glory. I am preeminent. I will go at any length it takes, taking on human flesh, being born in the likeness of men, humbling myself like a servant in perfect obedience to the Father, submitting myself to death, death on a cross, dying, taking the wrath of God on myself, rising from the dead in order that I might be acknowledged as preeminent. That's what we see here. Do you see that whether it's creation or now or the future, it is all about Jesus Christ? It's always about Jesus Christ. And as we'll see next week, brothers and sisters, or friends, if you don't know the Lord, you will acknowledge that one day. Acknowledge it now. He is to have the first place. This is the purpose of the incarnation. The Son of God endured death and rose from the grave to raise us from self-idolatry to genuine worship. That's incredible. That's incredible. He might be preeminent. Why? For in him, verse 19, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Parallel to that, and through him to reconcile to himself all things. He's preeminent because all the fullness of God dwelt in him. The eternal Son, now that we saw in verses 15 through 17, shifts to the eternal Son incarnate with humanity on him, a part of him. The two natures united but not mixed. The firstborn from the dead to conquer all. God cannot die, but God can experience death in his unity with human flesh in the incarnation. This is the Christ of Christmas. The one born to Mary and Joseph was born to be preeminent. The shepherds acknowledged that. The wise men acknowledged that. Anna and Simeon acknowledged that. Zechariah acknowledged that. And we are to acknowledge that. He is the reconciler of all creation. The one born to Mary and Joseph in the manger was born to reconcile all things to himself. Well, what does it mean to reconcile all things to himself? If reconciliation is necessary, that implies animosity. As I said a few moments ago, all of this creation decided no. Mankind and a third of the angels said no. We want to be God. I want to be God, not you, me. Romans 1, we've exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images representing mortal man and birds and creeping things, etc., etc. So broadly speaking, to reconcile all things to himself, it's to restore the order that he originally created, to bring order, for the creation is to be recreated in such a way that the Son of God is acknowledged to be supreme and Lord of all. That's broadly speaking. Specifically, it breaks down into two categories. First and foremost, to rescue his people. To rescue his people. You see that. Look at this. And how does he do that? Through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace, that's the idea of reconciliation, by the blood of his cross. Do you want to know why ultimately this text is telling us Jesus died for you? So that you would worship him. So that you would acknowledge who he is. That you would see that he is preeminent, that he is Lord of all, creator of all, sustainer of all. And as he's doing now, reconciler of all. He's taking our disordered, chaotic universe and bringing it back into order. Read Revelation. That's what happens. And he accomplishes this by his cross. But also, I think reconciliation takes on a broader idea here because you see that he is over these powers and these rulers and these principalities, et cetera, listed in our text. And also, I believe it's in Colossians 2, Paul says that through the cross, he triumphed over them, disarming them, and making a show of his glory pretty much in his enemy's face. So what does the Son of God do? He takes all of his enemies that are trying to usurp his throne, and he puts them under his feet and says, no more. I am King, I am Lord, I am over all. So reconciling the universe is that all, whether it be in his wrath when he takes vengeance upon his enemies, or in his mercy when he finally completes our salvation and gives us glorified bodies and brings us home to himself and we acknowledge him as Lord of all, the universe is as it should be. God's enemies subjected under his feet, God's people reconciled and their home. And this is accomplished by the blood of his cross. This is the direction, my friends, of redemptive history. God created the world for himself. His creation rebelled against him. God is so jealous for his glory, so loving towards his people, and so just towards his enemies that he entered into our rebellious world in order to live, die, rise again through the person and work of Christ so that we, his church, and all creation might see and acknowledge that he is over all through the Son. This season that the church sets aside to focus on the incarnation is good. But it must not be isolated for why the fullness of God was pleased to dwell in him. It was so that he might be above all. That's the point of the incarnation. My friend, if you're here this morning and you have not yet bowed the knee in joyful recognition and submission to the preeminence, the first place of Jesus Christ, your life is driven by your own desire to make yourself over all. There's no neutral ground. This is why our world is full of chaos. As I've already said, we have 7 billion people running around who think they're God. The Son of God will make all of his enemies bow the knee, as we will see next week. But he desires to save you. to change your heart so that you see rightly him and savor him as the supreme one that he is, that he's lovely, that he's beautiful, that he's good, and that he cares for you. And he came to live and to die for your sin and rise again so that you might, if you turn away from your sin and place your confidence in your standing before God in what Christ has done for you, you will be forgiven and enjoy peace with God. This is what all those who were baptized today were saying to us, that this has happened in their life and last week as well. My brothers and sisters in the room, those of you who have already submitted yourself to the Lordship of Christ, there is no category of our lives that Jesus Christ is not Lord over. Not one. Not what we think about, not what we watch, not where we go, not how we spend our time, not what we say. When the world looks at our lives, they should gather by observation that we esteem the Son of God as over all. I ask you this question as your brother, and ask myself this question. When your neighbors and your coworkers and your friends and your family, as you're going to gather this Christmas season, hopefully with family, when they interact with you, when they listen to you, when they watch you from a distance on social media, when they watch you interact with your children, what message about the Lord of your life are you communicating? Is he preeminent right now? Now, there's also hope I want to give you, because every single one of us should say, oh, not everywhere, not all the time. What this text assures us of is that in the end, for his people, we will indeed truly and completely acknowledge and love the fact that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. That's hope. That gives me hope on my worst days of sanctification. I don't know about you. This also, I want to say this to some of you in this room. This makes sense of our suffering. Apart from God existing, apart from God reconciling all wrongs and making them right, there's no point to your suffering. None. If you deny that God exists, what's the point of your suffering? Nothing. If God exists, if Jesus Christ is Lord of all, and this is the end, you know for certain that the suffering you're experiencing right now will one day bear fruit. Will one day all things will be made right as the Son of God reconciles not just us, but fallen creation to ourselves, or to himself, where when we're reunited with loved ones who have departed before us, and we no longer deal with the pain and sorrow of this earth. So I say in closing, what child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap was sleeping? This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him laud, to bring him praise. The babe, the son of Mary, but also the Son of God, who is over all because he created all, he sustains all, and he will reconcile all. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you. We worship you for imaging yourself to us through your dear Son, your perfect Son, your divine Son. Son of God, we thank you for coming into this world to take on human flesh, to dwell among us, to live and to die, and to rise again so that we might acknowledge your lordship, love you for who you are. You are great. Lord, I pray if there's any in this room who have not bowed their knee to Jesus Christ, that have not acknowledged and treasured him as Lord, that today would be the day that happens. For us, your people, Lord, who so quickly seep back into self-idolatry, Lord, free us from that again. Renew us again. Make us have progress in that, Lord, we pray. And may we enjoy this divine Son for all that he is. We pray this in his name. Amen.
Amen. If you're able, I invite you to stand and sing with us as we give all glory to Christ.
Should nothing of our efforts stand, no legacy survive, unless the Lord does raise the house in vain, its builders strive. To you who boast tomorrow's gain, tell me, what is your life? A mist that vanishes at dawn, all glory be to Christ. All glory be to Christ our King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All glory be to Christ. His will be done, His kingdom come on earth as is above. Who is Himself our daily bread? Praise Him, the Lord of love. Let living water satisfy the thirsty without price. We'll take a cup of kindness yet. All glory be to Christ. All glory be to Christ our King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All glory be to Christ. When day the great I am, the faithful and the true, the Lamb who was for sinners slain is making all things new. Behold, our God shall live with us and be our steadfast light, and we shall e'er His people be. All glory be to Christ. All glory be to Christ our King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All glory be to Christ.
Just drop voices.
All glory be to Christ our King. All glory be to Christ. His rule and reign will ever sing. All glory be to Christ.
Amen. I want to encourage us as we part with two words. I ended early, so it's okay. Colossians 4, it tells us to walk with wisdom towards outsiders, that our speech should be seasoned with salt, that we should know how we ought to answer each person, which implies gospel conversations. I encourage you, pray that God opens a door for those opportunities this Christmas season, that God would open that with your neighbors, with your families. Second thing I want to read to you is from Psalm 8, which is a messianic psalm about the Son of David that we just read about in Colossians 1, and I'll leave us with this psalm. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against His anointed, saying, "Let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us." He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord holds them in derision. Then He will speak to them in His wrath and terrify them in His fury, saying, "As for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, 'You are my son. Today I have begotten you.' Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage and the ends of the earth your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now therefore, O kings, be wise. Be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest He be angry and you perish in the way, for His wrath is quickly kindled. But blessed are all who take refuge in Him." Take refuge in the Son of God. Go in the grace of our God.
Hi, my name is Pastor Jason Hoy. We're so glad you found us and watched the service online today. If you have any questions about the sermon or the church in general, please visit our website at cedarcrest.church or email info@cedarcrest.church. We would love to see you in person and get to know you better. Our services are every Sunday at 10 a.m. God bless.